So I think we'll get started. Thank you all for coming. Any students, there is a sign-up sheet in the back, as you probably know. So this is part of the material body lecture series, so thanks to the Horning Endowment and also to the Hunter Endowment who contributed toward this series. Lisa Temple-Cox is an artist in Britain, based mainly in Colchester, which is in the south of Britain in Essex. She has an MA in Arts in a Social Context from the University of Essex, and she's exhibited at many sites in the US, the UK, France, and Italy. And she has many works of public art to her credit, as we'll hear about on Wednesday. Just of kind of looking forward, tomorrow Lisa is doing an exhibit from 5 to 8 at the Optic Gallery, thanks to Melody Owen for organizing this, which is at 225 Southwest Madison. There will be snacks, wine and cheese. And Wednesday, Lisa is giving her final lecture in the series on the practice of public art, which is in the Pan-Asian, Asian-Pacific room upstairs, which will include a display of the cabinets of curiosity that we made on Saturday at a workshop at the cabinet shop Pouch Creek that Lisa led us in, which was pretty fun, even though it was pouring rain. So, and just for the remainder of the Horning series, next month on Thursday, May 4th from 1 to 4, over in Lascelles will be the last event in this year's Horning series. And we'll be doing a mini conference with three speakers on the topic of Kennewick Man and repatriation. Mm-hmm. So this will include a display of student posters. So if you have any graduates or undergraduates who are working on relevant topics, please let them know about this opportunity. We have two posters so far, and it would be nice to have a couple more. So without further ado, I'm going to let Lisa tell you about her head in a jar.
Thank you very much. And I'm really, really honored to be here. It's just been an absolute blast. Lovely university and lovely people. So this lecture is basically based on the work that I did during my master's, and it was a kind of retrospective look back at the influences that kind of led me to the work I eventually showed. And initially when I started it, I was thinking about public arts, and I was thinking about a lot of sort of constructions. I was very into sheds at the time, sheds as art. But I kind of shifted from sheds to heads. So this is a kind of look back at why and at the influences that kind of led to that decision. So the formal title of it is Making Myself a Monster. What I became interested in was the teratological specimens in a lot of sort of 19th century museums, the babies in the jars, all the sort of deformities that used to be so commonly exhibited as or almost sideshow. It's a very fine line between sort of sideshow and science at that time. So when I was thinking about my work and what I wanted to do, the first thought that came to me was, what is it that makes these specimens so compelling and repellent in equal quantity? So they're accidents of nature which suggest something other than, you know, the normal self, but they're not outside of ourselves or nature, they're recognizably part of it. So it's that sense of ulteriority which gives the specimens their fascination, I think. And that appeal is tied to the uncanniness, because it's the familiar within the strange. And the second thing that occurred to me was the dialectic concerning racial identity, which is that the colonizing power creates the native other. So it suggests that the European colonizer doesn't exist before his encounter with the native, and this invention is dependent on its negative other, because, and I think this is a quote from Said, I don't have my references here, only through negation of that other can it invent and maintain its own identity. Now, I find this significant because I'm a product of a mixed-race marriage between an expat and a native Malay. And I had an interesting expat colonial childhood. Ooh, I missed the thing. You should have had this slide when I was talking about medical collections. Sorry, I'm professional. One thing I forgot to say before I started is the beauty of being an artist is that you can kind of cherry pick between a lot of sort of different research strands without really having to research them too thoroughly. So just to go back to the things in jars, this is a picture of the Hunterian Museum in London. That's how it looked before the war. Now, it was bombed. Now it's a big steel and glass thing. But this down here is the Mutter Museum in Philadelphia, which has maintained that sort of Victorian aesthetic, which I think is quite charming. So to go back to this whole mixed race, colonial, other dialectic, this is a picture of my former school in Malaysia. Ah, there you go. Which is a boarding school. It was built by the Raffles family high up on Penang Hill as a means for colonists to go and escape the heat in the summer months. But it was also used as a sort of refuge for their children during the emergency. And then it became a boarding school, which is where I went. And yeah, that's me. You'd never think, so cute. So the importance of this particular sort of dialectic didn't become clear until I came to the UK. When I was at boarding school in Malaysia, everybody was just, you know, everybody. We had all sorts of kids there. But when I came to England, then I realized that, in fact, I was the other. I was the outsider. And my experience at school could possibly be read as, the, you know, precisely the attempts of my schoolmates to maintain their sense of self and identity through assertion of my otherness. And they made it very clear that I, you know, was not local. And not only that, but then I kind of realized that the borders between sort of normality and the monstrous were more kind of rigorously delineated here in a way that they hadn't been in Malaysia. You know, in my Malay mother's village, those lines were a lot more blurred between what was real and normal and what was sort of actual or what was actually slightly uncanny. And she always used to tell us stories about somebody's uncle who got eaten by a snake, or someone else who got eaten by a ghost. And all these things were equally real, they're equally valid. So it was actually after many years of trying to fit into this Essex way of life that I began to explore as an artist some of the confusion inherent in my own sense of identity, because I'd come to England thinking I was English. It turned out I was not. So, if, as Roy Porter suggests, our sense of self presupposes an understanding of our bodies, I thought perhaps an understanding of the body might reveal something about one's sense or knowledge of self. And there had been a point when I was at school when I was very much divided between art and biology, but I was steered towards the humanities, which is now why I now speak very bad French, instead of having a much more biological understanding of the body. So my interest in bodily materials actually peaked after a visit to Gunther von Hagen's Body Worlds. And this is an exhibition in Brussels in around 2001. It was quite an early showing of it. But actually, it wasn't in the end the sort of weirdly posed, plastinated bodies that interested me. It was like right at the end of the exhibition, there's a small display of wet specimens. And he was sort of going, this is how we used to preserve specimens before plastination. But actually, in contrast to the rest of the exhibition, where you kind of have this, what's been called an emotional anesthesia from being subject to all these bodies outside of the case, so plastic. This section was where all the people were clustered around in the dark, just sort of like with that mixture of fascination and horror that I felt. And this is not actually from Gunther von Hagen's exhibition, but it's such a cracking image of exactly the things I was looking at. But then Gunther von Hagen's work was inspired by the work of Fragonard, quite directly. And Honoré Fragonard, 1732 to 99, that's for the historians. This is his Anatomized Cavalier. And his work sort of draws the gaze in a way that von Hagen's preparations didn't. There's something very sort of compelling and horrific about the way he preserved his specimens. And he himself was denounced as a madman for his pursuit of this. His écorché, man with a mandible, they're lovely, with his rolling glass eyes, I thought it's a beautiful vision of a man horrified and quite horrible in itself. And these can still be seen in their original venue in the Veterinary School of Alfort in Paris, now known as the Musée Fragonard. So just to go back to just to briefly visit artists and anatomists through history, Benjamin Rifkin said, "Physicians and artists have always shared a fascination with the human body," which seems quite obvious to those of us that are interested in these things. But the connection between artists and anatomists is very well documented. Can't talk about this without mentioning Leonardo. Obviously, he was both artist and anatomist, the most artistically gifted scientist, blah, 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 Rifkin. And he sort of epitomizes those roles, as you can see in his anatomical sketchbooks, although the notations appear in his figure studies, I think, from much earlier. But Leonardo never published. And it wasn't until Andreas Vesalius's De Humani Corpus Fabrica that, I should have used high quality images, that the first atlas of human anatomy was published, and one which, unlike sort of previous work of the time, which was based on Galen and used animal dissections, is first to show details of the dissected human form drawn from life. Now, anatomists and artists have lifelong collaborations to bring to life the human body in various stages of dissection. Vesalius was thought to have used a pupil of Titian's, Jan van Kalkar, although I think this is somewhat debatable now. And a later anatomist, Bernard Siegfried Albinus of Leiden, had a 20-year collaboration with the engraver Jan Wandelaar, notable for his sense of shading and values, but now especially famed for romantic and delicate drawing in Albinus's Tabulae Skeletae e Musculorum Corporis Humani, where the male figure with his displays his deep muscles before the placidly grazing form of Clara, the rhinoceros, who was a popular sight at the time and I believe was on tour. And Albinus obviously visited Clara. And I've seen a copy of, an actual copy of this work in the Historical Medical Library of Philadelphia. But this particular image, this particular plate, does sort of pop up in a number of different anatomical collections. I think there's something very compelling about the sort of conjunction of semi-dissected figure and rhinoceros. And I've seen it in all over the place, in Philadelphia, in Leiden, and, you know, every medical museum should have a picture of a rhinoceros. So, and I think there's one in the Boerhaave.
No.
Yes, there was, in the Boerhaave in Leiden. And they obviously have a copy of this book as well. So another notable collaboration, which struck my eye, was the one the engraver Jan van Rumsdijk had with the Scottish obstetrician William Smellie, and later with William Hunter, who's the brother to John Hunter, whose collection became the Hunterian collection. So it was astonishing work that he did for Anatomia Uteri Humani Gravidi, known as the Gravid Uterus. Was a real breakthrough in the time, I think, because really we're completely moving away from that sort of Renaissance tradition, and this is a dissected body, and a lot of the sort of English anatomists made no bones about these being dissected bodies. And quite often when I show this slide to my students, because I give this lecture regularly, this is when the gasp of horror emerges from the back, usually among the fashion students. I don't know why, they're particularly sensitive. This is just to show the original red chalk drawing of Van Rimsdijk and the steel plate engraving that was later made for the book. Just incredible work, incredible. So, when I began my research in the medical collections, there were sort of two different avenues that I was really looking at. One was the wet specimen, the fluid spirit specimen, bodies or parts of bodies preserved in fluids. And the other was the wax moulage. And the moulage or cast came about to serve the needs of sort of dermatological teaching, because if you preserve a body part in spirit, it loses its colour. And if you want to learn about, you know, diseases of the skin, you have to be able to see what colour those pustules are. So, and the wax allowed for casts made from living subjects, but still allowed for this sort of three-dimensional study. This is a Townes wax from the Gordon Museum in London, and Townes was one of those celebrated moulage makers who made no bones about working from corpses. This is probably not a corpse. What I found interesting about this is, although it's a cast, it's a wax cast of a face with early calcinated cypriloderma, it's placed in a jar, like the wet specimens, in an attempt to make it more lifelike, or, you know, so that students really felt like they were looking at an actual specimen. And there are rows of these jars in the Gordon. It's a very compelling sight. So there's a lot of work on wax moulages, which I won't go into because there's going to be a huge conference about it in London, I think, this year?
Yeah, September.
September, so everything you ever wanted to know about the wax moulage. But there, you know, the tradition is, there was one I saw in the Deutsche Hygiene Museum of a woman giving birth, and the mold, the model is actually cast, it's built around the woman's own pelvic bones. It's very disturbing. Are you okay? Sorry. but the other thing that is quite interesting about the moulage is quite often you would have casts of the hands, the surgeon's hands in the display. Here's one. You can see their little hands floating around like sort of little disembodied cherubs, peeling apart the body or holding the eyes open. Sometimes with the little cuffs. They're always male hands. Little cuffs and sleeves on them. And there's a particularly disturbing collection at the Hospital of Saint Louis, the Musée des Moulages in Paris, which is just walls and walls of these casts, some with hands, fingers, some without. And the wall of syphilis is something to behold, it has to be said. But what I particularly liked about those molds in Paris and others is that they only cast the part of the body that had the disease. So they were very selective, unlike the sort of Madonnas, the full body figures. You just got whichever bit, whether it was a tongue or a hand or part of a face, and they're all carefully mounted, and in a lot of cases the artist who made them signed the boards they were on. And there was something, this isn't from the Musée des Moulages because you're not allowed to take photographs in there, but it's, you know, you kind of get this strange effect of a part of a face, as if the whole of that person is then just summed up by that part that had the terrible, terrible thing. And they are basically hyper-realistic and therefore incredibly surreal. So inspired by this, I decided to attempt casting my own face. And I had a lot of fun with that until, being very clumsy, I started dropping my molds. Mm-hmm. And but what I found interesting was in these processes of the cast coming out, breaking or being dropped, is they began to take on sort of deformities which I hadn't intended. And this is part of my face which hit the floor. And there's something about the process of taking a part of your body and just showing that part of your body to the world. And when I started doing this, I realized that actually, although the moulages were very, very realistically colored, when I was taking these casts out of the mold, I was very struck by the fact that they were very white. And if we're looking back at my other ideas of sort of racial identity, I quite liked the fact that they had no color at all. And I began mounting them on colored boards instead, sort of reverse what they were doing in the medical museum. Now, if any of you do come to the other talk on public art, the place that I got the boards from is it is a dismembered piece of public art that I will be talking about in my other lecture. When it came down, I had all these colored boards and nobody knew what to do with them. So quite a few of us artists sort of ran up. I have some of those. Several of them are creating nice raised beds at my allotment at the moment, which I think is quite symbolic. But yeah, so I was using basically found colored boards and my faceless post-colonial, but colorless post-colonial face. So at this point, I started looking again at the wet specimen. Here's a lovely one, Frederick Ruysch. Hand holding the eye's vascular tissue. Ruysch is justly celebrated in creating the most amazing specimens because he was able to maintain the color. And I think his recipe is still secret. Mm. Peter the Great was so taken by his specimens that he bought the lot, but there are a few still in Leiden. And he was, what era was Ruysch? I can't remember the dates.
Late 17th, early 18th.
Yeah.
1730.
He had strange ideas about sort of anatomical display, which was, you know, that they should be quite decorative and symbolic. And, you know, this is a child's hand holding its own vascular tissue, and that isn't the most disturbing one. But, and his daughter would make lace and little cuffs for all the specimens, and they were like little babies' heads with little hats on. It's very... Yes, they're beautiful and incredibly disturbing at the same time. So, they have been described as objects between nature and representation, art and science. And it is really quite uncanny to see these things further deformed by the curve of the preserving jar. So, and obviously the notion of the uncanny comes back to Freud's essay on it, the Unheimlich, which means, I think, literally unhomely. And he accidentally sees his reflection in a train door and is repelled by it, and then he realizes it's himself. So you have this sort of moment of uncertainty about what you're actually looking at. And I quite like how this idea of something sort of sinister but homely is echoed by this preservation of things in jars. You know, you preserve anatomical specimens for later consumption by students or whatever, and you preserve your fruit and pickles for later physical consumption by the body. So you kind of get that effect of homely and unheimlich in the same space. This is another slide from the Boerhaave in Leiden, which shows a deformed peak and also a jar of apples. The apples are not actually presented here as foodstuffs. They are also deformed. So, and this sort of uncanniness, I think, is particularly true of the teratological specimen. So you get a preserving jar that acts as a little pseudo-womb with a little monsters floating inside it in this sort of urine-coloured liquid as if awaiting the moment of their own birth. And sometimes over the years, the liquid evaporates, leaving the specimen sort of curving down in the jar as if they're trying to, you know, retain the safety of the amnion. And... this is one from the Mutter Museum collection. And actually, while it's quite a poetic image, it's not actually true. The expression on their faces is usually anything but placid. The illusion of the amnion is ruined by the evidence of autopsy, you know, the lack of a brain, large stitches, glass rods holding in position. And in the case of the Cyrenum in the Musée Fragonard, which is this one here, it's actually held in position by a cord around the neck. So it's very disturbing, and the Cyrenum particularly is in a veterinarian museum, and it's just, for no reason that I've been able to ascertain, in amongst displays of sort of animal pathology. So I began making experiments anyway, inspired both by these methods of preservation and you know, notions of uncanniness. And I started creating little maquettes, heads in jars. And starting on a small scale, obviously, I had this idea of toying with the idea of the wet collection. The idea of spirit collections is that they should preserve the thing that's in it. But then I thought, what about if I, you know, if I made the heads in material that decayed, or if I used fluids that were intended to be homely but actually were, changed through time. And in case you're wondering, for these experiments, this one is kombucha. Mm. I think it's wax head in kombucha. And there's something wonderful about kombucha because it is a living liquid. And on the surface, it grows a skin. Now, the middle one is milk. Milk. The most nutritious of liquids is the one that decays fastest and becomes the most vile. And there was there was a point during my experiments when I accidentally knocked over Milkhead in the studio that I shared. And I was really, really unpopular. They evacuated the building, and I think the carpet had to be taken up, which I thought actually was quite, you know, it's quite symbolic. And this is a control head. That's just oil. See, very scientific methodologies going on here. So, and, you know, the artist Mark Quinn made a cast of his own head out of his own blood, which I thought was sort of the ultimate self-portraiture. But it is, it's very fragile, and accidents have happened when the electricity has failed. So I was looking at symbolic materials, basically, making the heads out of things like clay, wax, bread, shit, fat. Because that amused me. Shithead? Fathead. Breadhead, right? And then using these various liquids as a sort of living fluids to reverse the notion of the liquids in the jars acting as a preservative and to reference the sort of familiarity of the foodstuffs in the unhomelike environment of the laboratory. But first, in order to do this properly, I had to cast my own head. So much of what we are as humans, and particularly as women, is determined by our appearance. And a lot of what how people judge us on our appearance is determined by our hair. So I decided that really, in order to face myself properly, I had to divest myself of this veil of hair. So I shaved my head, and I made my first uncomfortable self-discovery, which is that the back of my head is quite flat. Now that I have friends who are anatomists, apparently it's called brachycephalic. But at the time, I thought my mother had done something unmentionable to me as a child. And I went round to visit her and look at her head accusingly. Hers is flat too. It's plainly genetic. So this is my first head cast. It's a two-part head mould, for those that are interested, using a dental alginate. So the back was poured first and then covered in plaster to hold it in place. And then the front was poured. So it's just literally front and back. However, it broke apart quite badly. It wasn't very good quality alginate. And I only managed to get one cast from this mould, which was this one. But I was quite taken by this because it reminded me of another famous life mask, or in this case, death mask, L'Inconnue de la Seine. She was a very famous but unknown suicide whose body was taken out of the Seine, and in the practice of the time was to, they would lay the bodies out so that family members could come and identify them, but this only worked for so long. So they used to cast, make death masks for their faces. She was never identified, but she became very popular with artists all over Paris. People still have copies of her mask on their walls, and they're all over the place. Now, also, she became the model, apparently, for a doll used in teaching mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, known as Resusci Annie. So she has been called the most kissed face in the world, unlike mine. Anyway, at this point, I decided to go back to the museum. So interest in medical collection, and particularly for teratological specimens, as I said earlier, really straddles a fine line between sort of science and sideshow. Early collections that were owned by surgeons were open to the public, and these sort of displays sort of blurred the borders between the gallery and the teaching museum. And when I was visiting various collections, like Hunterian Welcome in London, the Dupuy Trainer Fragonard in Paris, I thought, who's going to these museums? Because it's not just the medical professional. In fact, it's hardly the medical professional nowadays, but it's the sort of curious and the creative, the sort of artists, writers, musicians. And I quite often overheard interesting conversations among these people when I was in these museums, although I'm not entirely sure the ones in French I got were right. These are two from the Musée du Poitrain. They're faces half eaten by cancers. And part of their compulsion comes from the really obvious and horrible effects of the disease. But part of it, for me anyway, is the uniqueness of their faces. They are recognizably individuals. You know, one has this sort of soft, very soft, silky hair sort of floating in the fluids. And the other one, you know, is quite a raffish chap with his beard and frowny eyebrows. And there's a particularly disturbing one in the Mutter Museum in Philadelphia. It's not on general display. It's down in the wet room, propped up by a metal bookend on the shelf. And it's a Negro face, her head, cut in half. And for some reason, it's been enucleated. The eye's been removed. But the thing that really caught my attention about this was this little collection of pimples on his cheek that made him very human for me and made his incarceration in his jar even more horrific, actually. But, undeterred, I go back to the workshop, have another go at casting my head. And this time, one of my colleagues was actually intrigued enough by my bald head, and he's a professional sculptor, to make the cast for me. And so it was a three-part mold. There's my bald, shiny head. So it started at the back, and then he did the chin and neck, and then he did the sort of face bit separately. Now, by the time I'm doing this, word had got round college, especially in light of my earlier attempt. So huge numbers of art students rocked up to take photos of my shiny head. And the thing that I really noticed about this particular process, apart from Terry got a little freaked out as he was splashing plaster onto my head, and I thought, I'll just have a quick puff of my inhaler, and he went, you're asthmatic. they're covered. The thing that got me about this process was there was a point at which everyone was talking to me, they asked me questions, how does it feel? There was no alginate at this time, there was no sort of rubbery intersection between, it was straight on with the plaster. And the plaster heats up as it sets, you know, it's an interesting process. But they talked to me all the way through until the point at which my face disappeared under the plaster. And at that point they began to talk about me. And I could hear them talking about me over the top. And
anymore.
Just made that shift from subject to object.
Wow.
Just through this removal of my features. And I'm not quite sure if... Yeah, there we go. There goes my face. And apparently myself. So, but that was a successful mold anyway, and apart from a brief moment of fear which stuck to my ears, I got a really good cast. And the first cast I took out of this mold was a rubber expanded latex thing, so as not to damage the mold. And if you think back to my opening slide, that's the mold I'm looking at. It's a sort of spongy, rubbery cast of my own head. And I was delighted at this uncanny experience of literally coming face to face with my face, and had all kinds of inappropriate behaviors, such as you don't get to see head of a jumper. I stuck it under my jumper like a sort of alien baby about to give birth. There's all kinds of interesting things. Interestingly, my friends, my colleagues, my fellow students, were absolutely grossed out by my relationship with my own head. Mm. They said it's the most disturbing thing they'd seen. Pretending to give birth to it was probably the most disturbing thing they'd seen. Alien baby is not just amusing analogy, because there is a scene in Alien Resurrection where Ripley enters this room full of sort of rejected or malformed mutants that I think the company are trying to make a crossbreed between Ripley and Alien. But what we have here are all these failures of what is already a horrific process. And in a way, this kind of reminds me of Julia Kristeva's essay on the abject. You know, it's really the monstrous mother is worse than the alien mother in the early films, because they have this horrific quasi-human aspect to them. They're sort of doubly deformed by their failure to actually live up both to the monstrosity and to their humanity. So I eventually made a gel flex mold and a master mold from my first head cast. And the reason why it has this sort of thrown base to it is because this was a sort of tradition at the time, the Galton collection of life and death masks at UCL in London. They're all mounted on these little sort of, as if it was a bust of Beethoven that you'd have on your piano. And quite often the name of the person would be sort of engraved in the base. And actually looking at the Galton collection, you quite often couldn't tell whether they were life or death masks, apart from some of the hanged ones where they were a bit. With life masks, sometimes you can actually see a little bit of tension around the eyes, but you can't always tell. And in fact, when I was making multiples of my head, I was so excited at this wonderful whiteness, the whiteness of the plaster, that I thought I'm just going to make them all in this sort of plaster material, rather than all the other lovely and abject materials that I thought about making them in earlier. Fat would have been a little problematic. But I just decided to go totally with the plaster, the white plaster. Anodyne is aspirin, I thought. And I thought we'll just go with the liquids being abject. But interestingly, when I was casting these, people in the studio would often come in and refer to them as death masks, even as I was standing there breathing next to them. So I think, you know, that line between life and death and familiar and the uncanny continues to be blurred in these objects. So eventually I commissioned a number of jars that were sort of watertight, big enough to contain my whole head. And I built a cabinet to put them in and proceeded to fill the jars with different liquids. And like with the maquettes that I did earlier, rather than filling the whole jar with the liquids, I just took it up to the nose. Because actually, there's something very uncomfortable about seeing a head up to its nose in liquids. It's just at that point of suffocation that I think brings out a sort of sympathy. You have a sort of sympathetic sort of relationship with them, even though you know they're not real. So I was looking at symbolic and transformative fluids. And the nice thing about being an art student is you can play about with all this stuff, and no one tells you you shouldn't be doing that. So here we have wine. Representing the blood of Christ. Now here we have urine, which was symbolic of the Laplanders drinking reindeer urine in order during their shamanic rituals. Here we have the classic milk, like the offerings that are poured over Ganesh during Indian rituals. But here, my control jar is water, and I decided not to put a head in that one. And oddly, during the exhibition, this is the one that most people found disturbing. It was like, look at all the gross heads. Where's the head? yes, the absence absolutely made it much more frightening and uncanny. Now, unfortunately, in the end, casting my head didn't actually, I don't think I made work that was in any way as exciting or as compelling as the original specimens. It's not something I'm ever going to be able to do again. It's an interesting process to go through, and as you may find out if you see some of my other work, I've kind of moved away from it a little bit. But there was something really, I think, uniquely, in terms of self-knowledge, this whole process of going through these experiments, although I didn't understand, I didn't manage to create the kind of work that I really wanted to make when I started out, actually, I did achieve one of the things that I said I wanted to do at the beginning of it, which was basically to put my own head in a jar. So that is the basis of, that's pretty much the end of this talk. If you are interested, I have moved on to other things, and just to give you a little flavour, I'm moving more into the lines of mapping, because one of the interesting things that came up during my research in these museums is that by my being there, I was making connections that perhaps hadn't existed until I was in there actually making these connections. And when I was in the Musée du Poitrain, for example, I don't know if I've got this chart on here. Oh, yeah. This is me working out some of these connections. When I was in the Musée du Poitrain in Paris, I didn't realize it at the time because I was drawing heads in jars, but the museum contains the brains of Broca's aphasic patients. So these are people that have had accidents to a certain part of their brain, now known as Broca's area, although I think speech is now Wernicke's area, I'm not quite sure. But they couldn't speak, they had difficulties with language after their accident. I think one of them could only say oui or je or something. I'm looking at you because I think you're the... Okay. So there's Broca's brains in Paris. Now, this reminded me that the Hunterian Museum had Babbage's brain in a jar. Have I got a drawing of Babbage's brain? I don't think so. Oh yeah, there it is. Babbage, obviously, was the inventor of the difference engine, the very first computer, a thinking machine. Babbage's brain pretty much looks like anybody's brain, you know. And from the Hunterian, I went to the Mutter Museum in Philadelphia. And there, for no reason that they could clarify, they had a death mask of Hunter. Hunter from London, right? And also, while I was in Philadelphia, at another museum, a book museum, I saw the death mask of James Joyce. James Joyce, obviously, famous writer, great use of words, wrote Ulysses when he was in Paris. You can see where I'm going with this now. So we have people who couldn't use language in Paris, and we have James Joyce and Philadelphia studied medicine in Paris and they gave it up to write Ulysses. And actually, weirdly, another brain that I saw in London, I think it was at the Wellcome, you can just see the slides here, slides of Einstein's brain, brain slices. Mm. Where is Einstein's brain now? It's in Philadelphia. So I started this whole process of mapping various collections, and it got a little clumsy, and I won't take you through the whole thing, but it involved Edinburgh and the death mask of Dolly the Sheep. It involved Antwerp, Burke. There are sections of Burke's brain also in Edinburgh, and Edinburgh also houses an enormous collection of life and death masks, including people like Audubon. He passed through, they cast his face. You're not getting through here without leaving your face behind. You know, and it took me back to Paris. And if we're looking at life and death masks, you see this one here and this one here. This is Keats. Keats, the poet, also studied medicine. And he studied medicine under, I've forgotten his name, who did the first successful surgery for an aneurysm. There are all these connections, I think, between literature, science, medicine, and art that I'm slowly now starting to sort of put together. But if you're interested, these two particular photographs were taken by a photographer called Joanna Kane, and she's published them in a book called The Somnambulists. And they are photographs of the life and death masks from the Edinburgh collection. But she's photographed them as if they were black and white portraits of people. And when you look at them, you can't see if they're alive. You can't tell if they're alive or dead. They do look like they are sleeping. And so you can actually see, effectively, what would have been a photographic portrait of Keats. And down here, William Blake. And I think I will end there. Thank you very much. Thank you.